Get him out of here.
Come.
Celebrate the tricentennial. Mardi Gras without a cake.
All right, now we're talking, baby.
Man, that's a good-looking cake. Where'd you get it, Randazzo?
Nope, Nora.
Mm-hmm. She and Sharif wanted to show their gratitude, combined a little of the hometown bakery with one of the oldest traditions in their new town. Not fantastic.
Might have a little more besbosa in it than nutmeg, but sure looks good.
What's wrong about this town, man? Everyone has their own flavor, you know? It's too bad Percy's not going to get to enjoy.
Keep fishing, LaSalle. Keep fishing.
Hey, $5 says she's with a new flame. Not that I'm gambling. I'm not gambling.
It's totally gambling.
To a new dog.
Dom Izzo.
Really? Really, Dom?
No. I like what Dom's doing.
Okay. Dom Izzo.
Jeez, come on, Dom. What do you think I am, a magician?
Yeah, I'm fired up, Dom. What else could I say?
Absolutely. It was great to get on the field, and then Dom came up to me, and I'm trying to walk away from me. I just wanted to enjoy myself out there.
Hot mic.
Great job.
There's got to be some kind of intelligent question about something. Is a
hot mic.
Hot mic.
On the networks of WDAY.
You know, if it's not about sports, I find it very hard to concentrate.
Here's Dom Izzo.
Dom Izzo.
Good Thursday morning. It is the second quietest day on the sports calendar edition of Hot Mic on WDAY Extra, KSFL TV in Sioux Falls. Good morning to our friends in South Dakota and Inforum.com on a Thursday morning. We're nearly through it, folks. We're on the other side of the sports abyss. After today, there's games happening from now until basically this time next year. We got through yesterday, which was quiet. I mean, we had Wimbledon happening. If you're not a tennis person, I got it. Get some dumb NBA games going on. That was probably soccer last night, which we'll show you in a second. USA continues to disappoint us. I don't care what level of team it is. The ESPYs were last night, which I didn't watch. Might get in trouble for that since it was on WDAY last night. I watched the 1 minute I tuned it on was LeBron was up there and basically said he was coming back, which nobody ever thought for one solitary second he wasn't. So now we made it through that. So now it's Thursday, and we got a little bit more today. You know, golf tournaments are happening. Wimbledon's going on again. We're in the semifinals on the women's side. So we get through today, and then the baseball season resumes tomorrow. Twins are out in Oakland, everybody else playing. So we get through today, then we can take a deep breath. And like I said, 2 weeks from, or 3 weeks from today, three, that's it. 3 weeks from today, we're playing football. The New York Football Jets and the Cleveland Browns are playing football. 3 weeks from today, we can do it. It's so crazy that we're there. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our show. I am Dom Izzo. We got a great show. I'm really excited about today. We got some good guests, some fun guests. And, you know, that's the one thing when we get to this time of the year, we have an opportunity to visit with some guests that maybe we normally traditionally either wouldn't or get a chance to be in studio with, which is always, I relish that because most of the time I'm just yelling in the microphone by myself. It's fun that we get a chance to have some people here in studio. So we're going to do that coming up on our show today. Tomorrow, we'll be starting our new series as we get ready for the high school football season. We'll be having some of the area coaches here in studio to chat with us about the upcoming high school year. Excited about that. That's going to start tomorrow. We'll do that for the next few Fridays. That's the scary part there. I think we are five Fridays away from the first football games in North Dakota because they start absurdly early in North Dakota. So, yes, I believe five Fridays from tomorrow, we are playing games that count. I'm going to double check this. If we're the first out of the chute in the country, we got to be near the top in North Dakota. Minnesota, they still have two more weeks. August 18th, I think it is. Kyle and Michael know because they're going to be out there shooting the games, but I think it's the 18th is our first. 17th is our first week. 17th, 18th is football. Okay, so there you go. August 18th is our first. I have to double check. We might be the first in the country playing high school football. And like I said, we're five short weeks out from that. So that's to look forward to. Also, tomorrow on the show, West Fargo Cheyenne standout, one of my favorite players in girls basketball in the state. Brenna Dick will join us. She has announced her verbal commitment to play at the University of Mary. Did that a couple weeks ago, and she'll join us coming up tomorrow on the show. Okay, so with that said, one of the only sporting events happening, the Gold Cup, which for those that don't follow soccer, this is a tournament held every 2 years, hosted in the United States, made up of the nations in North and Central America. CONCACAF, that's what it's called, and for those that don't follow soccer. So that's Canada, obviously us, Mexico, and then the Central and Caribbean Islands. Central America, Caribbean Islands. We should be in the final every time this is played. I don't care if it's not our A team. That's what the excuses that came out last night. And again, it's easy to get mad at the U.S. men's national team because they rarely exceed expectations. Last night, they were facing Panama in the Gold Cup semifinals in San Diego. Great scene, great atmosphere. The game was scoreless until extra time. Panama in the white jerseys, Yvonne Anderson scores after Matt Turner, the goalkeeper who got out of position, not sure what he's doing. That's like a cartoon, just slides right on by. That's about as easy as a finish. Still an extra time, though. Remember, it's not sudden death. Jesus Ferreira, this is a fabulous. That's a golazo, is what I'm told, a one-timer in hockey. That's a great goal. His seventh goal of the tournament and ties it up at one. So we go to a penalty kick shootout. Christian Roldan here takes the penalty kick. Orlando Mosquera makes the save for Panama. That's huge. So now Alberto Calasquia, all he has to do is score, and he does, and that wins it for Panama as they're on to the final, and the United States is out. I don't even know if there's a third-place match. If there is, we should forfeit. As Panama wins, you know what? I was so despondent, and this is so ridiculous because it's the Gold Cup. It's not the World Cup. I didn't even watch the other match between Jamaica and Mexico. Mexico won three rips. So it's Panama and Mexico for the Gold Cup championship coming up on Sunday, which is in L.A. And immediately after, the soccer types that follow me and soccer fans, well, it's not the A team because they're all getting ready for the Premier League season or their own club league year. Okay, I get it. That wasn't our number one. But shouldn't we be losing at home to Panama? We shouldn't. If we're losing to Brazil or the Dutch or Argentina or Italy or England, Spain, France, okay, got it, sure. But we're not losing to Panama. We're not barely tying Jamaica. We're not losing to Costa Rica. You know what I mean? No, that is unacceptable. And I come as fun that I like watching the men's national team. I enjoy their games. I watch every, as we all know, we followed together this past fall, winter of the Men's World Cup. We were invested there. think everybody went crazy when we beat Iran, barely, to get into the round of 16. This seemed like we were just flat. And our whole national malaise on soccer will end a week from now. The U.S. women's team will open up the World Cup, which, as we were talking about with Drew yesterday, they're going for a third consecutive championship, something no one's ever done. That can rescue us from our doldrums on this. I don't know. Maybe I'm out of touch soccer guy, but we shouldn't be losing at home to those nations. I just, that doesn't make any sense. And you know who was more upset than anybody? Fox. Wait, because they're broadcasting. When that ball went in for Panama, or when the save was made in the sudden death of the shootout, I know I can't say that it's penalties, but when that save happened, every Fox executive threw their phone just because they know now no one's going to watch Panama, Mexico in primetime Sunday night. They know that. That's not going to work. So that was the big thing that happened yesterday, at least sporting-wise. The other big thing, as we teased about and what to watch, the Big 12, the first into the pool with its football media days that happened yesterday in Jerry World, AT&T Stadium in Arlington. And Commissioner Brett Yormark, who's been on the job now, this is his second year, last year made some headlines saying, hey, we're open for business, meaning expansion of the Big 12. Clearly, that was going to be topic 1A because the Big 12 is adding four schools this year. BYU, Central Florida, Houston, and Cincinnati are now members of the league. But they are not done. Here's just a quick sample of his press conference yesterday when he was asked about what the Big 12 is going to do going forward.
For a year now. When I said we were open for business last year, I think people took that as, my God, you know, this guy's new and he wants to go and disrupt, I guess, in some respects. But, you know, indicative of my opening comments today, open for business was that we were going to explore every and all possibility to grow revenue, to diversify our conference, and to do things that hadn't been done before. And we did a lot of that. Relative to expansion, I said coming out of our spring business meetings at the Greenbrier that we have a plan. And we have a plan for expansion. And I'm not going to really address it today. You can ask me, but I'm not really going to address it. We do have a plan, and hopefully we can execute that plan sooner than later. But as I've always said, I love the composition of this conference right now. Mm-hmm. The excitement the four new members have brought to this conference has been incredible. And if we stay at 12, we're perfectly fine with that. If the opportunity presents itself where there's something that creates value and aligns well with our goals and objectives, starting with the board, then we're certainly going to pursue it.
Okay, so he says something there. Maybe he doesn't say a whole lot. He's saying a lot of words, but who knows what it means. Pat Forty, the great college writer for Sports Illustrated, saying Brett Yormark eyeing potential Big 12 expansion on both coasts. And I think that is accurate. The Pac-12 has kept teasing us for days, months, weeks. I know I'm out of order there. On its media deal, it's going to be announced soon. We haven't seen it. Which means the Big 12 may very well be bullish on going and grabbing Colorado, old Big 12 member. The one that's out there that has gained some traction is Connecticut. And I know you're going to roll your eyes at me like, wait a minute, why? Well, Connecticut just won the national basketball championship, as we well know. And the Big 12 has asserted itself as, in my mind, is the top basketball league in the country. I don't think there's any doubt about that. Prior to Connecticut winning, the last two champions were from the Big 12 in Baylor and Kansas. But if I'm those leagues, remember, UConn is an independent in football, too. I'm checking in on him, making sure, hey, are you happy here? What can we do? What can we do to help out? What can we do to make your stay here more comfortable? Now, I have the map of what the Big 12 will look like this season. Remember, Texas and Oklahoma are out of here after this coming year. Guys, here, thanks, guys. So look at this, by the way, now. West Virginia, Morgantown, West Virginia, Provo, Utah. Let's do a Google map on that one, okay? Because that's hilarious to me. Because that's now a Big 12 rivalry game. Again, we're all about the student athletes, right? We're all about how do we make this great for the student athletes. Provo, Utah, where Brigham Young is, to Morgantown, West Virginia. 1,927 miles. Okay? I don't even know what Provo to Orlando, that's where Central Florida is. Let's do that one quick. And I know everybody flies. I got it. But they do play basketball. That's 2,300 from Provo to Orlando, where Central Florida is. Yes, now we know Oklahoma and Texas will be off this map. But look at this map doesn't even have Connecticut in it if they want to go there. Connecticut is edited out of the map of the Big 12. Look at Iowa State now as the northernmost out there. It makes sense. Now, Cincinnati and West Virginia are rivals. That will be great. It'll be a great basketball deal. But this is why Yarmark is still looking at adding. Like, they're not done. Gonzaga has been talked about as well. Don't forget that. Gonzaga's out there. And we know they don't play football, but clearly for basketball, that would be a monster addition. Talk about this in basketball. If you had Kansas, if you had Baylor, and you had Gonzaga, holy cow. You got three of the top five programs in the country in your own league. ACC, Big Ten, SEC are thinking, oh boy, we're way overmatched there. Like, we got nothing to compete on those guys. There's no doubt about it. That would be what their league is looking at. That's a tough sell. There's no doubt. So just as we get into this now with all the different media days, the Big 12 will wrap up today. Next week, the SEC is going to go. Greg Sankey will speak, the commissioner, likely on Monday. The SEC has 4 days of it, okay? But you're going to hear every top college football coach say something beginning next week. And, of course, we'll feature it here on the show. But I just thought that was interesting to show what the Big 12 has and what they're looking at moving ahead. Let's set up our show here for you here on this Thursday. I mentioned we got a fun guest lineup for you, a couple of great in-studio guests. Coming up at 9:35, one of our favorites, MSU Moorhead head football coach Steve Laqua will join us. The Dragons are just a couple of weeks out from starting fall camp. We'll get the update on how the summer went, how spring went, and look ahead to the 2023 season coming up at 9:35. At 10:15, we are pretty pumped to have, well, arguably the greatest quarterback in North Dakota State football history. He is the winningest quarterback in FCS history, left North Dakota State with 4 national championships. He was the starting quarterback for 2 of them. One of them, he got them there. Now about to enter, this is crazy, his 5th year in the National Football League. Los Angeles Chargers quarterback Easton Stick will join us in studio. He'll be with us for about a half hour. We'll chat everything on the NFL, the Chargers coming back for another year in L.A. His quarterback camp was held yesterday. We'll chat about that. And, of course, we'll chat some Bison football. That's coming up at 10:15. And a heck of a lot more here on our show this morning. We'll take a break. We come back. Our series continues on the Spotlight Games for the FCS in 2023. We'll do that when Hot Mike returns right after this. Welcome back, everybody. Big show Thursday, off and rolling. We found out how long it is, how the distance between Provo, Utah, and Morgantown, West Virginia today. So geography lesson on Hot Mic here. Who says we don't learn stuff on a Thursday? So excited about that. We've been doing it each day, and we will for the rest of this week and all the next week and into the following one as we're chatting on the Spotlight FCS games for this upcoming 2023 season. If you missed it, Monday we did weeks 0 and 1. On Tuesday, week 2. Yesterday, week 3. Today, as luck would have it, we're doing week 4. So now we are into the middle of September. These games being played either Thursday the 21st, Friday September 22nd, or Saturday September the 23rd. Just a heads up on this. This is the week that both North Dakota State and North Dakota and South Dakota State are off. Majority of the Missouri Valley Football Conference is not playing football games this particular day. So the picks might be slim, but let's rock and roll. And we're starting in the Big Sky for our first one with a good matchup here. Montana State and Weber State is our first game. 7 o'clock that night on ESPN Plus. Now, here's a rematch of a playoff game from a year ago. This time it's at Ogden when they played in Bozeman. And, of course, Montana State won that game. That's the game they played twice. The regular season was the debacle game where Weber State committed 4 safeties in the game. The playoff game was a bit closer, but Montana State won them both. Now Weber's got them in their place. I'm curious to see how that one plays out coming up. That's on, I mentioned, September the 23rd is when these games are happening. In the SoCon, Chattanooga, the Moccasins will take on the Samford Bulldogs. 2 o'clock game on ESPN+. Samford, of course, a quarterfinalist last year. Good football team. Chattanooga had a chance at the postseason. Screwed it up at the end. How they finished. I think they'll be good again this coming year as well. I'm keeping an eye on that one for the third week of this, or week 4, excuse me, of this FCS season. Sacramento State and Idaho as they go back to the Big Sky. Now, I'm interested in this one. Sac State, are they going to take a step back? New coach there, of course, after a semifinalist appearance in 2022. They lost to The Word, lost a bunch of their players. Their best player, Cameron Scadabo, went into the transfer portal against an Idaho team that broke through last year. Remember, Idaho won in Montana. They lost a crazy game with Sac State a season ago. They made the FCS playoffs. They lost in the opening round to Southeastern Louisiana. Everybody nationally thinks Idaho's the team that's going to take a step forward. Last year, they lost by Sac State by 3. I think they get them this year. This year, it's in Moscow. That'll be fun to watch. 3 o'clock that day on ESPN+. And then from the Colonial, two old rivals, New Hampshire and Delaware. 5 o'clock, Flow Sports. You can roll your eyes at that one. But we got to figure out who's going to be good. We need to figure out who is going to be the team in the Colonial this year. William & Mary was by far the team last year that made it. They boat raced by Montana State in the FCS quarterfinals. Who is going to be the team that rises up and has a really good 2023 in that year? We've been talking about Delaware for the better part of 5 years. Delaware is yet to win a playoff game in that stretch. And I'm not counting the spring year. I know they made it to the semifinals in the weird spring season where they got dusted by South Dakota State. I mean, they haven't done anything since then. The fall of 21 and last year, Bupkis from Delaware. New Hampshire, are they? I mean, after they had some really good teams. We haven't seen much out of them. We're going to see a CAA team just a few years ago. 2018, Maine was in the FCS semifinals. They lost to Eastern Washington. Since then, they haven't been very good. So it lends the question on that. It goes back to our conversation we had on Tuesday of this week. As we look at these spotlight games, and I'm telling you, folks, it was slim pickings for week four of the season. I'm eager when we get to conference games now that hopefully we have some better matchups. Because, just by the way, for people wondering, that week of the Valley, and we'll do this when we get closer to the start of the season and look at each week of the Valley. Here, the three games in the Missouri Valley involving Valley teams that day. Lindenwood is facing Illinois State. It's hopefully a good week for everybody to take the day off. Utah Tech, the former Dixie State, is playing Missouri State. And then Western Illinois, a night game against Southern Utah. Ooh, that is a slim pickings for that particular week. Next week, then, the conference season begins, and you actually have some pretty good matchups. But for week four, there's far and few between. But that, again, goes back to the point we're talking about. It's like, we know who the top couple teams are. After that, we don't really know who's super good. We had a couple teams bubble up last year. You know, the Word making it to the semifinals. Can they do that again? They have a brand new roster again, new coach. Sacramento State, I think everybody's of the mindset. We'll get the Big Sky poll here in a week and a half. I think they're taking a step back. Is Montana going to move forward? You know, Montana, like, well, they're back. And then the Grizz had a disappointing year and then got beat by 100 points in Fargo. We've talked about Montana State. Idaho. You know, I any of the teams out east we just mentioned. It's just a – that's why I think for some fans there's just a general malaise about FCS football. Because we're still searching out there who's going to be any good. Yeah, there's going to be some teams that, like Samford won 10 games, whatever they did. How good were they? I mean, they barely won their second-round game against Southeastern Louisiana, or else we would have seen them here. And you know what? The Bison would have ran all over them. Maybe the game would have been a little bit more exciting. I don't know. But, I mean, Samford barely won its second-round game against the Southeast Louisiana team that barely won its first round game against Idaho. You see what I'm saying? I mean, like, we're not seeing anyone go for, here's the top tier. If we know the top tier is South Dakota State, North Dakota State, right? And then the next echelon is Montana State, maybe by itself, because I don't know who's in there with them. And then under them, you've got, you know, Incarnate Word and Montana and maybe Samford, William and Mary. I don't know. I don't know who's making up that. But none of these teams are hopping up to the next level, at least in my mind. That doesn't seem like it's happening. That's just one of the many storylines we're going to be chatting about as we get closer to the start of the season. We're due for a break. We'll take one now. Coming back, one of our favorite guests, weekly guest during the fall, making a rare summer appearance, MSUM head football coach Steve Laqua joins us in studio when Hot Mic returns after this. Welcome back, everybody. Hot Mike on a Thursday morning. WDAY Extra, KSFL TV, Inforum.com. We're talking football, which is always great. And it seems fitting that our next guest here is here today because we chat with him regularly. I'm trying to think back of, I've had a daily show at WDAY one way or the other for the better part now of 14 years. Our next guest has been a part of it for nearly that long. Steve Laqua in studio. In studio. Normally you're on the phone or the Zoom. It's great to see you.
Yeah, it's awesome to be in person.
How about this, by the way? We're talking about, like, I gave Grant Olson a hard time about this because he's one of our more recurring, outside of weekly guests like yourself. You're up. I mean, you're in the pantheon, man. Hall of Fame. I don't know how you feel about that, but.
I don't know about that Hall of Fame level. Might have to adjust that definition there.
I had people saying we love when Lockway's on. We love how honest he is. I'm not kidding you. I got emails about this. So
were they from my dad? My mom and dad.
Talking about your Cavalier football days. So we always appreciate that. How you doing? How's your summer been?
It's been good. I think like everybody, it goes by faster than you want it to. And but we're trying to enjoy those times and be great dad times, great husband times, and we just got back from vacation last week.
I was going to ask, did the fam take a vacation?
We did. Where'd we spent some time in Park Rapids with the in-laws, and so we had 24 people together for a few days, so that has its ups and downs with that.
No doubt.
But it was good, and we kind of got to the end of it, and I said, I think I might have spent more time helping everybody else have a great vacation than getting one my own, but that's what you do as a dad and whatnot.
So I always equate this now. After July 4th, summer's over. Is that accurate as a football coach? That once you get past the 4th of July, it's like, all right, I got basically 2 weeks and it's time to go.
I feel like it's a little different, similar, but it's when we drive home from that 4th of July vacation.
Yeah.
It's kind of, all right, we have one last gasp.
Yep.
And then we're going to get a break and then it's go time. And it's, you know, kind of like a Apollo 13 mission. You're launching off and
I bet you're going
stuff
to
ain't going to go
in the submarine.
In the submarine.
Right?
It's not going to go how you want necessarily. Things are going to get beat up, and when we return, it's going to look a lot different. But for good or bad, that's kind of how it rolls.
If I would have told you that you'd be still at MSUM in 2011, now here it is, it's 2023, would you have believed me?
You know what? Maybe not. You know, because I think I'm not really exactly sure what would have unfolded. I think about halfway through that journey, I think I would say, yeah, I would believe that, that this has kind of become the home and the place that I want to be, and it works out for a number of reasons, for what we do at MSUM and the guys there, for my family, for the community. I told somebody the other day that I've been in this community all but 2 years since my parents dropped me off in the fall of 97 to be in the dorms at NDSU, and this is home, and my parents live in West Fargo. My sister teaches at Fargo North. Like, this is home. It's great people. I've seen this community grow. I've seen the show grow, right? It's
I appreciate
from just wanting to diving to be on it to hey, now I'm on it. You know, the crazy, you know, things that happen like in Fargo Moorhead, the growth and how awesome it's been. And I remember I tell people this story that I'm at Shanley High School. I just left NDSU a couple years before and NDSU had been 3-8 the year before. And you kind of asked me off air, you're like, hey, how many games do you think that Craig has to win to keep his job? And then it was, whatever, national semifinals, whatever, 25 national champions since that, whatever. You know, and just the changes that have happened. And it's a great place to live, and I love it.
I'm so glad you're going to be here for about a half hour here. There is some serious stuff to discuss, and I know many have seen it in the community here over the last couple of days. A former player of yours, Ty Jochim, passed away. Suicide, it sounds like, which is jarring. Tell me when you heard it and you're just what your reaction to that. This is a guy that you knew well. He grew up here, played at Fargo Davies before he came to play for your team.
Yeah, he's, you know, I mentioned it earlier. I've been in this community since 97.
Yeah.
And I do feel like it's a large community, but it's a tight community, I think, especially in the sports world. And so it was like a punch to the gut, right? It's, I think, all of us when we get that news kind of like that's tough and it hurts, and you know, you try and process that and you're in disbelief and you try and start reaching out to other people too of hey, making sure they're aware, how are they doing, and so it was spending some time doing that and really probably maybe making sure some other people were doing okay yeah. more before us because, you know, there's guys that take that tough, and there's certainly guys that are on our team currently that knew him. There's guys that have graduated with him that spent a lot more time with him than I ever got to. And so those are real things, and they leave holes. And you know what? You're trying to help people through tough times. And a lot of guys were probably in that situation once they found out.
I appreciate your honesty on this. It's good to talk about it, to have it out there for people that are struggling, that there is help out there. What do you remember about him as a football player, as a person in your locker room?
Yeah, he was great. He did what was asked. He was tough. He played the game hard. You know what I remember is when he transferred to our program, and so he kind of came in and said, "Hey, I'd like to join the team." And you know, he wanted to play running back, and it was going into spring ball, and we didn't have a lot of we had a lot of depth at running back. So I said, "You're really not going to get any reps. Like, we have to figure out these other guys. Would you play defense?" And so I was like, "That's kind of your ticket to get on." And so he played corner for that spring, and he was a fish out of water. But he attacked it. He did it. He worked hard at it, and he had perseverance. And then, hey, this guy can make it. We had some changes at running back. Like, hey, you move over, you get an opportunity. Now he's playing in games. You know, I remember the touchdown he scored against Mankato, just kind of the look and excitement in his eyes and that. And you remember those goosebump moments. And so that was kind of a culmination from, hey, I'm walking on as a cornerback.
Yeah.
And now I'm in a running back, and I'm scoring, and might have even been on homecoming day and whatever. And so I think, you know, those maybe that's the one that sticks out to me the most.
There are a lot of things that you have under your umbrella that you're never taught. There's no handbook. A situation like this, I mean, like you said, you're reaching out to others. Who's reaching out to you? Like, how do you handle that? How do you cope with something like this?
Yeah, there were a lot of people that reached out. Whether it's the Northern Sun Commissioner, to other coaches in the league, to my athletic director, to people close to me, and just, you know, letting us know that they're there or whatever. And so that helps. Certainly, I think my faith is an important piece to that, of helping through difficult times. And so there is no handbook for it. There is no handbook, but you really just try and take the next logical step, whatever that is, and you hope that you take those in the right steps that lead you to the right place. And I think that's kind of what I've learned in this whole job, but I've learned it in life too. Yeah. There's never a clear line to what the end result is, but there's probably a clear enough line to take the next right step.
I appreciate your speaking on this. We talk every week during the football season. I mean, there's devastation on losses or injury, but that is such a minute thing. Really is. It is. When you have something like this happen, it just puts everything in focus. Like, okay, what are we really getting upset about? What really is frustrating us on a day-to-day basis? Right? At least to me, it does.
Yeah, it gives you perspective. Yeah. Right? And proper perspective gives you clarity. And we all need that at different times. And I think that's, you know, in a situation like coaching football, to this, to, hey, when you are in a tough place and handling difficult things in life, sometimes it just needs a change of perspective that can help you out of it. And I think that's the piece of, there's a lot that goes into it, but when you think about it, where do some of the greatest stories come from? They come from rising out of that hole and in that depth. And I think about, maybe this is just a guy thing, but how many guys in their college house or with their brothers at home wrestled around and put a hole in a wall, right? And then slid a couch over, rearranged, move a poster. But there's a story to that. As you come out and later you laugh about it, or you talk to your parents about it. Like, we all have those holes in the wall that we go through in life. Everybody, regardless of what you see on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, we have those holes in the wall, and they can become great stories. And so it's trying to bring that out to everybody and be like, hey, it's okay to have that hole in the wall. We can build from that, and there is a brighter day.
Well said. I want to take a break here. We'll come back. We'll chat some football stuff, including a couple of your former high school players. One that's going to be snapping the ball to Aaron Rodgers this year. Another who's got like a multi-million-dollar media company starting here. We're going to do that much more with Steve Laqua in studio as Hot Mic continues after this. All right. Back with Steve Lockway here as we wrap up hour one. Fiercest high school football rival was who in the glory days when you were playing at Cavalier?
Oh, Harvey.
Those were the guys? Doubt. Okay.
Those were the guys. They beat us in the semifinals twice. Still stings.
Comes right to mind there, yeah, too. No hesitation.
It still stings. That's my high school career ended in the Fargo Dome in a semifinal overtime loss.
See, how about that?
Still there.
So you have that, and then you have the first. Now you don't have the claim of the only overtime game in Dakota Bowl history anymore. You had that for a long, long time. Now we got one that just had the 9-man championship just had it this past year.
Yep. It's
you got to share that now.
Those are great times. I just get goosebumps thinking about high school football is great. The game of football is great. Being able to as a young kid play in the Fargo Dome or the Alaris, like you're talking about people that play games with vehicles lining around with their headlights on, and now they're on turf field.
My first 9-man experience was actually Hankinson and Winemere. Which a great 9-man rivalry in southeastern North Dakota, and they exactly had that. I'm like, and coming from New York, I'm like, what is this? I mean, it was nine. We don't have 9-man football back home, and like, wow, this is awesome. And it really, like, you're talking about the cars pulling up and everything. Not great lights. It was fantastic. I love that on Friday nights.
Absolutely, and the town was shut down.
Yes,
everybody was
absolutely.
There. That's what you lived around, and I think that's how I grew up. Like that was big time. Yep. Big time was a game and. In a community of 1,500 people.
Well, speaking of big time, because I think people now forget that you coached at Chandler. You mentioned that and brought that from what was really hard. I mean, I thought it was really similar what you did at Chandler to what you did at MSU. I mean, I know you had that great success you had at Chandler, like you have with the Dragons yet, but I look at those title teams, and man, you had some great play. I mean, Connor McGovern, people now know him as an NFL football player. He's the starting center for the New York Jets. He's the longest tenured member of the. He might be of the team, certainly of the offensive line. And this year, he's going to be snapping the ball to Aaron Rodgers. I mean, when you think about that, how much do you guys still chat?
We keep in pretty good contact. Yeah. And so
he told me that you still chat pretty regularly.
Yeah. And sometimes he's had some tough years.
Yes.
Right.
And Jets
and
have
I
not
think,
been very good.
And I think on those years, I probably texted him more.
Yeah.
Right? Remember why you're playing the game and whatever, and it's been great to see what he's done and surpassed anything that I ever thought of him. And I think I didn't know how it would turn out going to Missouri.
Yeah.
He adapted and got better and better and got his chance and then made it and has continued to make it, and it's fun to be able to see what he's done and how he's really given back too to the community. Yeah. He's still involved. He's still back in the summer.
Able Games has become a thing.
It's huge, and he's building a home here, living here. Like it's not like he grew up and left and forgot about this place. It's still close to him.
How surreal is going to be on? I know you don't watch a ton of NFL, but on Sundays when you're going to see Aaron Rodgers, it is for me as a Jet fan and a guy I covered in high school that's snapping the ball to him.
It's crazy, right? It's of how that worked out, and you just think about fortune or how things work and the ripple effect and what happened where, and it's wild. It really is. And great things can come out of Fargo, North Dakota, right?
And the guy who he used to snap the ball to, one of his best friends, and the guy who played for you, in Miles Montplaisir, who, again, I think people forget, was a pretty good quarterback in his days in high school and in college. He played how many different positions for you?
Oh, at MSUM, was tight end. He played linebacker, wide receiver, quarterback. He did a little bit of everything.
And now he's this media conglomerate. I mean, just when you look at that, and I don't know how often you've seen his videos. I mean, just what do you think? Just tell me about your relationship with Miles.
Miles, it's been great. I coached him for 9 years.
Yeah.
How many people can say that?
4
in high school, 5 through college, had to give him bad news. Like, hey, you're not going to be the starting quarterback, even though we had this great relationship and great run at Chandler and bench him and move him on. And he found a role, and you see what he's done. And you could see how his mind worked in high school and college. College, he ran his own company, started his own company, selling stuff, and it didn't work out and whatever. But he had the mind to be able to put those things together. Mm-hmm. And then that you look, and I remember talking to him when he started getting into the social media advertising. Where'd that come from? You got an exercise science degree. He's like, I just taught myself online and YouTube videos and this and self-education growth, look at that. And I remember him coming in with different plans and core values that he's going to run his business by and live. And so he's kind of had this focus. And, you know, I thought the cool thing was the last time I talked to him, he's like, I love the business side of things as much as I like the videos and the personality and all that. And so I think that's been awesome.
Like, he had to go buy more space for what they're doing. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's great. And, you know, he's continued to get better. He's continued to grow. He's taken what it is. I think he's taken some things, I think, from, you know, the Shanley program, the Moorhead program, about building a culture in that building, right? People only maybe see the videos or get the apparel. But there's a whole team of people that work there that's become a family, right? Yep. And a place that they love going to work and maybe gives them a paycheck that changes the lives of the people there. And so I think, you know, he's really doing great things. And again, still in our community and giving back.
Are you mentally prepared to play a non-conference football game this fall? Like, I've joked about this with you on the air, like, but it's actually happening because Upper Iowa decided to leave and the league pivoted to everybody gets to play a non-conference game. How close did you have any conversation with Concordia on that?
Tried. Looked at that a little bit, but they were already in a schedule and had made a commitment, and we're going to stand, you know, by their word and whatever. Yeah. And I think that's, you know, that's important too. And so I wish it could have worked out. Maybe it
everybody.
Works out in the future. We'll see how that plays out. I'd love to be able to have that chance, but.
So you have McKendree University? Is that who's
McKendree? Okay. And so you ask,
where are they from?
Am I Lebanon, Illinois? Okay. Near St. Louis. So you ask, are we ready? I said, well, we're probably as ready this year as we can be. Now, if you ask me next year, and it's a 12.5-hour bus ride, I don't know if I'm quite ready for how to take on that challenge.
So you'll play them next year?
So it'll be a home and home. And so we'll do that return trip. And
lucky son of a gun.
I don't know exactly how you do that because we've never done anything of that distance. So you just get up and leave at 6 a.m. on Friday, and you show up there at 7 p.m. and go to bed and wake up and play at noon.
Yeah.
And, you know, we did both agree to play at noon so that we could – Start the trip back for both of us. But yeah, that's I don't know. We'll see. It'll be fun. It's different. New challenge.
Tell me about this football team. You made a change of quarterback last year. Went to Jack Strand. Tell me about that decision and looking ahead for him at 2023 of being your guy this coming fall.
Yeah. Tough decision because Tommy played the year before. Right. I think he played really, really good football. We were into the season. I think it was game four, and there maybe wasn't a pure indicator that said, hey, we have to make this change. I don't think it necessarily was Tommy played terrible or whatever, but I think we saw enough things in practice that made us think, hey, there's maybe a chance that there's a higher window here, that we need to maybe make that move. And so we had to make it, you know, I don't want to say on a hunch or by gut, like, but not as much data as you probably want, but we made that difficult decision, and Jack had a great season. You know, he's a second team all conference player. That part worked out. I thought probably why it helped work out was how Tommy handled it. He handled it really well, like a champ. And I told him that. I told his family that. I said, you know, beyond football, when you think about it in life, like life sometimes gives you a crap sandwich, for lack of a better word. Yep. And sometimes you got to eat it and handle it. And he did. And he was a great teammate. And he's a competitor. And he's still battling to be the starter and whatever. But he still helped Jack learn the game plan and be great every week and support him and give him feedback in games. I think those are the type of people that you want, not just on a football team. That's the guy you want to hire. You want him in your business, whatever it is, hey, when things aren't great, he's still going to be the guy that's doing what's right. He's still going to be the guy that's helping people through being a great teammate. And so those, I think, are life lessons, right? And those are things we're trying to teach here. Obviously, we're trying to win football games, but life lessons. Our guys aren't going to the NFL. They're going to the game of life. So can they be great at – maybe they'll go to the NFL like Connor McGovern. Yeah. Maybe they'll become a social media star like Miles. But how can they take this experience there and really transform the world that they go out into live to, workplace, family life, whatever it might be, and take some of that recipe that we have and then be able to go change the world with it in their small worlds.
Can you stay for another 10 minutes? We got to take a break. Okay, we got 10 more minutes here with Steve Laqua. We'll break. We'll start hour two. Much more with Coach Laqua. Easton Stick coming up as well. You're a part of Powerhouse lineup. You're leading off, man. That's pretty. Table setter?
I could see that's me, and then Stick is kind of the closer. You wouldn't want me as the closer.
You're the starter?
I don't have that kind
You're the
of
ace? All right.
The fifth guy in the rotation.
We'll do hour two back after this.
This is Hot Mike.
Hot Mike.
On the networks of WDAY.
WDAY.
Here's Dom Izzo.
Back on hour two, you were so in demand. I was going to get you out of here at 10, but people want you here. I got Easton Stick waiting here, man.
It's one thing to lie to my face over Zoom, but right here in person.
Come on, man. Steve Lockway, good enough to give us a few more minutes. Can we negotiate here about your weekly appearance for this coming season? Can we do that?
I need to be paid for it? Is that what the people are saying?
My boss isn't here today, so go for it. You know what? I'll sign
the check. There we go.
Can we do that again this year?
Absolutely.
Boom. There it is.
Putting me on
the spot. Tradition continues.
That was a very good negotiator.
You can say no.
I
people
love it.
May not like you for it, but you can say no.
They probably don't like me anyway. You know what? That's one of the, I don't want to say highlights of the week. I'm not going to be, but it
you
is.
You don't
a,
have to lie to me,
it's
man.
It's a point during the week that I do like.
I appreciate
like, there's
that.
There's obviously higher points, but that is not one that I dread. That's one I kind of look forward to.
Well, I appreciate
to,
and, that.
Yeah, it's because of you. You do a great job of it,
and
I appreciate our relationship over the years.
Now the fact that, you see, Shanley's getting new turf and a track over there. I mean, I remember the early days when you first started. I mean, describe of when you took that job. Did you, like, okay, we're here, and did it feel like that?
Yeah, I was just probably trying to figure out what to do. With that first year, we didn't have a place to play.
No.
We played at Concordia and yes. South, and I think we were in the Dome, and we didn't play at the same.
I distinctly remember you playing at Concordia, now that you say that.
We were all, I remember it because I think I almost threw up on the bus before we got off there, and at some point afterwards, I'm like, what am I doing here? Like, we hadn't won a game, won a game in the year, like, we're not going to win. What are you worried about here? Like,
man.
It's come a long way, and that's been fun. It was fun when they opened the stadium with the turf. And now it's kind of the next phase.
That night, when you guys played Davies, your last year there, I remember the line of people was, I mean, there are houses now that are there now that weren't there in 2010. That was, we were live there. You and I talked that night. You and Thiel just was there. I mean, it was fantastic. That was a huge deal for the south side of Fargo to have, and now it's become, I mean, Troy's even put in a traveling trophy with it. It's become a thing.
No, it's been awesome.
That was unbelievable that night.
I remember that, and my wife watched our live deal, and that's when she told me, you are way too amped up. Like, you can't look like that on TV. That's like, you got to figure out how to calm down. That's like,
that's saying something next to me, because normally I'm pretty amped on television.
Maybe that's the only time I've been more amped than you. So,
we were chatting a little bit off air. Some new rules coming in for Division II for this upcoming season, including for freshmen. The Division I's had this now for, I think, 6 years. Finally, you're going to have it where true freshmen, doesn't have to be true freshmen, but you're going to have a three-game rule for guys that can play and keep their red shirt. Describe that and how that changes what you can do with your football team.
Well, I think it's exciting because it maybe helps keep people involved more. Like, it's not red shirt. Oh, you're cast off to the side.
Right.
Okay, you've got a shot to play in these games.
Yep.
So I think it puts their development a little bit more in the forefront than in what it's been. And so I think that's important. I think, honestly, as a coach, it saves me from some moral dilemmas. There's been, seems like one every other year that comes up and you go, okay, we're going to have to pull your red shirt and you're probably going to play one or two games. And then the starter's going to be back and you're going to blow a year. And we've had great guys have been, hey coach, I'm part of the team, whatever's best for the team, I'll do it. Mm. And they've worked out, but that's gut-wrenching as a coach, knowing that I'm taking that
You're trading their worst year for their best year. Isn't that what the coach's
axiom is, right? In a lot of cases, right? And I'll always try and say, now, you don't know. There's nothing guaranteed in the future. We've had a guy that he did that, and he played those two games, and then you know what? He never got on the field again and graduated as a senior and never played. And so it's a good thing we did.
Yeah.
That gave him an opportunity.
Yeah.
And so you don't know how it's going to work out, but I'm glad that it saves me from maybe some of those gut-wrenching decisions that impact lives.
Gage Florence, we talked, seemed like every Tuesday we're talking about him. What's the ceiling for a player like him, especially having the kind of year he had last year, knowing he's going to get everything thrown at him, the kitchen sink in terms of defenses this year, right?
Yeah, I think obviously there's going to be a lot of people that watch him maybe more intently, and so I think it's really important that a guy like Ryan Bieberdorf has a great year so that we keep defenders spread out. You got to have a 1-2 punch. I think that's important. I think the other thing that's important that people don't realize, we had six seniors last year in the wide receiver room that had a combined career catches of 24, I think it was. He had like six dads in the room helping him progress, learn, hey, he had all those coaches there. How's he going to do without having all those coaches and all that support in the room after a practice, between a series, whatever? And so those are some of those unsung heroes that, hey, how's he going to handle that now? Because he maybe won't have that like he did.
Last question before I let you go. Give me a player or two in your time with the Dragons that you thought, I'm not sure how this is going to work out, and then just totally blew up and became one of your – I mean, Damon Gibson comes to mind for me.
Yeah.
I don't know, but I'm not trying to put words in your mouth. Give me a couple guys that you're like, I don't know, and then was a stud for you.
Damon Gibson, for one, I want him to be a defensive end. He's an All-American wide receiver. I remember looking at Corey Ambrose on his recruiting visit, 130 pounds, 5'4", and I'm like, we offered this kid a scholarship. Like, what am I doing here? And he leaves us the third all-time leading receiver. Adam Jiska, I remember sitting him down and saying, hey, you know what, based on your high school film, you're really going to need to redshirt. You know, the odds of you playing. And then 3 weeks later, I'm talking to him about pulling his redshirt, starting. And then if he doesn't get injured, he probably sets the conference record for receptions
Absolutely.
In a career.
Yep.
Crazy, crazy things.
That's good stuff. I got a text message in from my good friend and your good friend, Mike Scogan, says, don't let Stevie be too humble. He was a good baseball player.
Well, I appreciate that. I remember, Mike, we played against each other, and I don't know if we ever won or not. But he had a small strike zone.
Yes.
I remember that. He was shorter than me, so figure out how to get some strikes across the plate.
It's great to see you. I really appreciate you coming by, especially talking on a wide variety of things. You know how much I appreciate our relationship, our friendship, truly is that. And enjoy the last couple of weeks of summer, and I can't wait to see you back out on the football field in not too distant future, all right?
Yeah, absolutely. Sounds great. Thanks.
There he is, Steve Laqua, head coach of the MSUM football team, joining us in studio. We'll take a break. We come back. The quarterback of the Los Angeles Chargers, NDSU's all-time winningest quarterback, FCS all-time winning quarterback, Easton Stick, joins us in studio. Hot Mic returns right after this.
Welcome back, everybody. Hot Mike rolls on Thursday morning. WDAY Extra, KSFL TV, and Sioux Falls in Forum.com. We appreciate Steve Laqua coming by. Always great to visit with the coach of the Dragons. And again, we're going to do that again, his weekly visits, when we get closer to the season at the end of August. We are talking football, and I mentioned after the 4th of July, it's over. Football season is here. It really is, because training camps in the NFL begin in less than 2 weeks. For our next guest, his free time ends pretty much after he gets done with our show. Super awesome to have the quarterback of the Los Angeles Chargers, Easton Stick, in studio. It's great to see you, my man. How you been?
Yeah, really good. Great to be here. This is a sweet setup you got.
I appreciate that. Like I mentioned off air, I got every old school helmet. I don't have a Charger one. Can you hook me up on that?
Yeah, we're going to make it happen. We're going to make it happen.
The powder blues are fantastic.
They're the best, right?
So we, during COVID, I think the Chargers put out their new lineup of uniforms.
Yes, and, yeah, rebranded like slightly, yeah.
We spent 10 minutes on it because I'm a nerd of this stuff. They're fantastic. What did you think of them when you saw it? Because you saw it, because Kyle played with the old school one, and I gave him a hard time, like, you never wear the powder blues enough, and then bam, you wear them all the time.
Well, it was perfect for me because I went in and had the last year of, there's a little bit of navy still in the powders, and we didn't wear them as much. And then they just rebranded slightly. The COVID year, I remember going out to the first practice or walkthrough of, there was like an acclimation period for training camp. It was so strange because of the COVID stuff.
Yeah.
And I go out there with my hat or a hat from a year ago.
Oh, did they rip it up? Somebody...
The equipment manager grabbed me right away. Duddy grabbed me. He's like, you got to go back in.
That's
I need you to, like, please put on a different hat. And I'm like, I barely noticed the difference. But when you look at them, I mean, it's a different deal. And the powders are great.
My my wife gives me a hard time because I have what I call like mustard pants, mustard color pants. But you guys do that's the it looks like it at least.
Yeah.
I love those.
Yeah,
man.
They're the old school like Dan Fouts uniforms. They're sweet.
They're fantastic. Yep. So, all right, we got our jersey conversation out. Although I will say I posted a photo of you your senior year in Vermilion when you guys broke out the yellow pants on the road.
And I was a huge advocate
that
for that.
Sweet.
I was pushing.
Is that right?
Yes.
I asked Coach Kleiman about it. Yes. I didn't know who loved the charge.
Because Coach, for the most part, like, he didn't care what we wore. And so we'd be in the captain's meetings. He's like, hey, guys, like, do you care this week? And I had pushed for, not everyone was on board.
Is that right?
I had pushed for the, we look at all the old video of the D2 teams, and they all wore the old school snorty helmet, yellow helmet, yellow pants. And I was like, guys, we got to do it once. And I was like, in Vermilion, like the D2 rivalry, this would be sweet.
What do you make of the all green?
It's different.
Yeah?
It's different, but I think it's a good change-up.
It's coming up the leaderboard for me as one of my favorites.
It's a really good change-up. You mix it in once or twice, and it's solid.
Did anybody ever consider all yellow? You got all gold.
I think that's a little much. That's a little much.
That's the only one. I want that one.
Yeah. I don't know. That's much for me.
Well, you're back in town, as we saw in the news yesterday, for your first football camp. I know we talked about this yesterday. I remember when you got invited to go to the Manning passing camp, how big a deal that was, and talking to you when you got back. Was that really kind of the genesis of this for what you wanted to do?
Yeah, I think so. I love the sport. I love the game. I love being around it. And I don't know, just going down there and seeing how they blended youth quarterbacks, which, like, you know, those camps are so much different than what they were doing with us as the college players. And so kind of blending that whole experience, they had a ton of panels and speakers, you know, because they're a 3-night camp.
Yep.
Like, you're staying overnight in the dorms. And so they're having different speakers come in, talk about how to use social media, what recruiting's like, the importance of education, all these different things on top of the football. And they did similar stuff with us. Peyton and Eli sat in a room. Chris Mortensen was there and was like, here's what the media is like. Any question you got, go for it. And I got pages of notes from that hour. So it was like the neatest experience just to have access like that. And I was like, man, this would be really cool, you know, if I ever got to a point where I could be on that side of it and do it. And so I just felt like there's, you know, area for that here. There isn't really anything like that. And so it was great to start it out. We had about 35 kids, some underclassmen, some upperclassmen, about 11 college players, and it was a lot of fun.
You've told me you've been wanting to do this for a couple of years, right? And just haven't with COVID and everything, it just hadn't worked out.
Yeah, just trying to find a way with scheduling. You know, the summer is so crazy for everybody.
You most importantly.
Yeah, I mean, we get 5 weeks, and so it's like that balance of like, hey, I feel like I need to get away because we just went through this off-season program.
Yep.
But 5 weeks, man, it goes quick, and you're in it, and you're in it. You know how it goes. So, and then with the colleges, obviously the high school, they're playing baseball, they're playing basketball, they've got their football stuff. There's just a ton going on. And so I'm really appreciative, especially the high school coaches. We had a bunch of high school coaches out, had dinner with a few of them on Tuesday night, and then they ran the camp. We couldn't have done it without them. And so for them to take the time, that made it.
What's the objective here? How big do you see this getting? You know, you've been to some big ones, I'm sure. Yeah. Growing up, I know you went to some big ones. Like, is there a threshold of how many you would like to have before you can't have individual one-on-one time?
Yeah, that's the biggest thing. Right. Is you want it to be intimate enough where you can get to know these kids, build a little bit of a relationship, when you're on the field, and really coach them hard. And so you're getting – useful information. We're not just out there messing around, running around. Like, it's not just one of those camps where we're just going to, take you for 4 hours and mess around. It's like, we want to really get something out of this, be intentional with their time. And obviously on the field, but off of it, we did a bunch of stuff, had some guys, local executives from Sanford, from Shields, Northwestern Mutual. We came in, did a leadership panel, and they talked about their experiences as athletes in high school and college. Now what it looks like for them in business and that transition. And so we did some cool stuff. But, we'll see where it goes. I just know I'm excited to be a part of it.
I got to ask a question now, because you mentioned about the media session. So when you came back, every question from myself or Kolpak was like a layup then, right? After that?
Yeah.
Like, what do they tell? Well, I'm curious. What do they tell you?
It's just like, the word protecting yourself came to mind. Yeah. And it's not – that sounds – aggressive, I guess, more than it needs to be. But just understanding that we're, in a really social media, it's just so reactive.
You're not on it, are you?
I
was going to say, never – no. I remember one incident in high school. Right. That was probably it, right?
That was – I think that was, the sign of the future for me.
We'll tell
the
story.
It was time to get off. But, I think I got rid of it. I was a freshman, I think, here on campus. And I was like, it doesn't make me
good
feel
for you.
Good. I was like – I got away from it and – I don't know, now that I'm off of it, it's like I have no desire to be on it, to be completely honest.
Boy, I'm jealous of that, I'm envious of that.
And there's a ton of good, obviously, that comes from
it. But
it's just just one more thing.
Especially in your profession and the position you play, that is a negative road to go down, that could.
It can be, and it's just like, I'd prefer to be a little bit more private. And, I don't know, I'm just a little less adverse with the phone than some.
So for people that don't remember, this was right before – during your senior year, you had already committed to North Dakota State, and then someone hacked into your Twitter account?
Yeah, it was we had iPads at school, and you're jacking around in class and getting on Twitter and killing time. And I think I just didn't log out of the Twitter account on that iPad. So the next class comes in, and one of my buddies
This is somebody you knew?
His younger brother is like a sophomore or something at the school.
I never knew that.
And went out there and wrote the tweet up.
Going to Rutgers? Was that it?
Yeah, exactly.
And I mean, that blew up back here.
Well, it was crazy
because
obviously the transition from Coach Bull to Coach Kleiman.
Yep.
And I had just come up here, this was the Monday or Tuesday after my official visit, where I came up here and basically told him,
I'm
good. Yep. Got to sit with Coach Polisek, got to sit with Coach Kleiman. Coach Riley stayed.
Yep.
And that was probably the biggest piece of it because we were really close. And so when that happened, my phone was buzzing in my pocket in class, going crazy at 9 a.m. I'm like, what is going on?
Yeah.
I get in the hallway. Coach Riley called me. Coach Polisek called me.
Kidding.
Everyone's freaking out. What just happened? So
that's unbelievable.
It's funny to look back. But
it
at
is
the
now.
Time,
it was scary then.
Absolutely.
Imagine.
And I'm so embarrassed.
Yeah.
I felt terrible. But it's pretty funny.
I remember I think we did a story on it that night, and then I'm almost positive I called you and we talked that night. I said, this was just a mix up, and I'm 100% still coming here.
Yeah.
I understand why you'd be done.
It's just,
there
I'm
was
good.
Nothing the positive came out of that. we talked yesterday about re-signing with the Chargers. You're gonna be back already. Crazy. This could be your fifth year in the National Football League. Tell me the thought process with you and your representation about coming back to LA. Justin is there, but there is a change in the QB room. How much did that affect your thought process about coming back?
Yeah, a huge part of it. And we talked, I have a great relationship with Justin. Obviously, there's a ton of comfort in being in the same place and not packing up and moving across the country and, where do you go? All that stuff that comes with it. So there's comfort there. And I think in this case, that was a good thing.
Mm.
I really feel strongly in Coach Staley our GM, Tom Telesco, and kind of the direction this thing has gone. And so for them just to express the interest, like, hey, we want to bring you back, meant a ton to me, obviously being drafted there. And,
yeah.
Look, the reality is I haven't played really at all. And so for them to have the confidence in me that they've seen enough, you know, in our own settings, that like, hey, we can trust this guy to come in here and compete and you know, hopefully help us win at some point, like, that meant a ton to me. And so, yeah, I'm really glad it worked out.
I know how much of a competitor you are. How difficult is it for you to be there on the sideline? Just that I'm, you know, you're one play away, but you're on the sideline.
Yeah, it was a strange transition, yeah, for sure. And I think maybe the thing that helped me was, as a rookie, watching Phillip Rivers operate and even Tyrod, I was like, okay, like, that's different. Like, I cannot do what they're doing, yeah, right now. I was like, I believe at one point I can, but I'm like, as we sit on September 1st, I cannot do that. You know, and so there was part of me that, yeah, was like, man, I want to be out there, but at the same time, I recognize, like, I don't deserve to be out there. And so I need to do things to get there. And the other cool piece was just, I followed Tyrod around everywhere. Yeah. And he was awesome. It was just like, dude, like, you're not going to, you know, mess up my routine. You're not going to annoy me. Like, you can follow me. It's all good. Mm. And so he's a guy that, similar to me, he was a late round pick.
Yep.
Was in Baltimore for 4 years through his rookie contract. Didn't play a whole lot. Gets to go to Buffalo. Wins the job. Pro Bowl. All those things. And now he's back in, you know, kind of a backup role with the Chargers. And so I got to watch, like, just, yeah, what he, how he operated and how he managed that competitiveness versus I need to help the team. And so there is a balance there. It's a little strange.
Yeah.
It really is. But it's part of it.
Did the thought process ever go through, Easton, you know what, if I go somewhere else, without a stable quarterback situation, I may have an easier road to play? How much was that? Did it go through your thought,
yeah,
process after,
definitely,
the season?
Yeah, absolutely. And you look, like, crazy things happen all the time.
All the time.
I mean, look at Trey's situation.
Yeah.
You know, in San Francisco, it's been unfortunate, but whoever's been playing has been
hurt. Got
hurt. Like, it's just one, yep, of those freak things. And thankfully for us, it hasn't, because Justin's, like, as good as it gets.
Bionic.
It's incredible. And that's a good thing. And hopefully it's that way for a really long time, because he's one of the best. Yeah. So, but yeah, you have those thoughts that come through your mind. It's like, man. But you also understand playing that position, playing quarterback, you're so dependent sometimes on what is around you.
Yeah.
Coaches, players, support, all that stuff. And so you can be thrown in a bad situation, and it's really tough, yeah, as it is. And then, shoot, you know, we're getting beat up a little bit, and that's it. So, you know, there's both sides, yeah, of it.
I have to bring up some painful memories, but you have been part of some amazing comebacks here. What was it like on the sidelines in Jacksonville that night to see you guys play amazing?
Right.
I don't know if you could play any better in the first half, and what happened in the second half of that game.
Yeah, I've never had that feeling, yeah, in sports before. It was crazy. I mean,
not even high school, I imagine,
no,
right? You guys were,
no,
amazing in high school.
Yeah, yeah. And like you said, we were on the other end, a few of them in high school, some comebacks and stuff, but never on the losing, yeah, side of it like that. And, you know, it was weird. The first half was weird because there were some things that happened. And
they kept throwing picks. Lawrence,
yeah,
kept throwing,
and, like,
interceptions.
Balls, it's like,
yeah,
okay, yeah, like, this, it's not going to happen like this. Like, this is not how the NFL works. You've been in it long enough, yeah, where it's like, these are one-score games 99% of the time. And so, you know, like, okay, it's not going to be 54-0 like it would be if you were in college playing somebody and you just – they roll over and that's what it is. But it just – it's one of those – what's crazy about it is the amount of time left in the game and the score,
yeah,
you look at it. It's like, okay, you're going to – to lose this thing, you're going to have to turn it over a bunch, or there's going to have to be like a freak special teams thing. And there wasn't.
And there, yeah.
And there just wasn't. And it was just kind of like a slow it still makes you a little bit sick.
I bet.
And I think, you know, unfortunate that it happened, but I think we've got a lot of those guys back,
yeah,
the majority of those guys back, and I think it's something that'll help us.
Tell me, I know I asked Kyle about this from his playing days in Kansas City. What is that? Is that as close to a college environment as there, Arrowhead?
Yeah.
Is that accurate?
Yeah, that's when people always ask, like, where's the coolest place,
yeah,
to play? And that's the first thing,
yeah,
that comes to mind, because it is. The fans are right on top,
yeah,
of you, you know, like they hear it at the dome. There's no sideline. The tailgating, all that stuff. You're driving through the parking lot. You can smell the food. Like,
mm-hmm,
that, it is. The fans are crazy. And so it definitely is a fun place to play.
I'm looking at the schedule. You got a trip to US Bank Stadium, though. So
yeah,
that'll
early.
Be exciting.
Yeah.
The Chargers are playing the Vikes.
Yeah.
I imagine there'll be more than a handful of Bison fans that'll,
yeah,
probably make that. Because 2 weeks earlier, they're coming because Tampa Bay's playing. And, you know, the Cody,
oh, yeah,
Mauch,
absolutely,
train. I'm sure you saw that
from
afar. Half
the state will be there. Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, it's
but,
fantastic.
You're getting to some spots. I imagine you're playing the Jets this year. You know I'm a Jets,
oh, yeah,
guy.
Yeah. Monday night, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you make of that with Aaron Rodgers going to be a Jet? Incredible. You got
the Hall of Fame game, so you get an extra game to watch. You got Aaron Rodgers, Hard Knocks. I'm sure a ton of prime times. So it'll be fun.
You're going to Green Bay, too.
Yeah. So I've never been to US Bank or Lambeau.
Or Lambeau, okay.
So I'm both pumped
this year.
Yeah, I'm really excited.
Before we go to break, and we're going to go down memory lane here, where I got you for another 15 minutes. You and I talked, I want to say, Christian Watson's freshman year. Did you? I talked with Coach Kleiman about it. He told me, I know he's going to be a stud. Was that even in your mind, either his true freshman year or his redshirt freshman year? You got the sense that, oh boy, this is different.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's one of those guys. There was a handful where it's like when Jabril got on campus as a freshman, when Trey got on campus as a freshman, and Christian, it was like, how did you get here? Like, somebody screwed this up. Because he was long, he was tall, and he was so explosive. That was the difference. Mm-hmm. Is watching him run versus other guys. It was like there's a twitch there that other people don't have. I mean, he just kept growing and getting bigger, and he worked his tail off. And I think that was the other thing. It's like he's still developing. So learning how to play receiver, run routes, all that stuff, just took time. But like the skills, like athletically, were off the charts.
The game against Colgate, he almost the bomb you threw to him. If you remember that, he almost scored what was going to be his first touchdown. Yeah. I remember I looked like, oh, okay, this is what they've been talking about. Yeah. I mean, we're just starting to see it. Yeah. Obviously, the 3 years after that went through the roof on that.
Crazy.
Last question before we go to break. Kyle would tell me this as well, and other guys. Is it really like on Saturday before an NFL game? Like, are you guys bragging on when you're watching NDSU play? Like, can you describe what that's like in an NFL locker room?
Heck yeah.
Watching
it's the best. It's the best. Because, like, they do it here. You have the walkthrough. You know, ours is typically Saturday morning before the game. Or you're at a hotel on the road. You come back into the locker room, and there's 7 TVs, and they all got different games on, and everybody's going crazy. And we would beat you, or we would have beat you, or we did beat you. Like, it's just nonstop, and it's every week.
You playing with any Iowa guys? You got some Iowa guys in your roster?
Nick Neiman, his brother Ben, was the starting linebacker on that team. And then when I first got there, Desmond King was
there. Yes, that's right.
But I couldn't give Des too much.
You have a pick in that
he
game?
He did it, but I did throw one on the first or second series on third down. It was kind of like a punt, though. You know, it was one of those.
I do remember, yes.
Like, let's just try to fit it in. Tough. But Coach Polasek was like, hey, just 14s on that side of the field. Like, just throw it over there. We're not even going to mess with it. Okay? Just don't even mess with it.
It was good. Let's take a break. Much more with Easton Stick. We come back. We'll go down memory lane here. Look at some fun plays from his time at North Dakota State. Back on Hot Mike on a Thursday after this.
Welcome back, everybody. Hot Mike rolls on Thursday morning. FCS all-time winningest quarterback, NDSU future Hall of Famer. I'm going to say that. It's going to happen. Easton Stick joining us. It's going to happen. I know you hate any sort of accolades like that. They're going to call in a couple years, just so you're aware. So in town for his first, we can't say first annual, that's that thing, inaugural football camp. And this is going to be a thing,
that's
right?
The plan.
That's the plan.
I really hope so.
Going forward?
Yeah, absolutely.
Pretty cool. I saw about 35 guys. I even saw Kevin Feeney's youngest out there.
Yeah, Jeff was out there.
He can zing it, too. Yeah. His older brother is up at UND right now. And, yeah, obviously Kevin played for the Bison. That is our segue. So this morning, I mean, I covered every game you play. So I'm looking at, like, all right, what games I want to – most of the time I talk to you after every game because that's the deal. Quarterback, you're going to get in the interview room. But sometimes not to get a good in-depth one. So I pick four separate plays I want to go through, if you'll indulge me on this. First is your last game as a Bison. National Championship 2019, Eastern Washington. The play that comes to mind is the deep ball to Darius Shepherd.
Oh, yeah.
We can play it, guys. Because you got crunched here. Tell me what's going through your thought process when you call the play, but you know you just got smushed there.
Well, I never actually saw him. So that makes it a little bit easier. You're not as tense. But honestly, great call by Coach Mess, obviously. It was a play or a variation off of a play that we ran all the time. It was actually the same play. You go back to Iowa my sophomore year that we threw the first play to Connor Wentz for like 20 yards. It's the same play. You just double move the receiver to throw it over the top. And so it's just a variation off of that. We ran it all the time. We ran it early in the game.
Yeah.
And Darius stuttered the route a little bit and then ran the comeback. And then with the plan, we're going to call this one later, and I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to stutter it, set it down for the comeback, and then I'm going to go. And so really the whole play was obviously the protection. But Darius, having the understanding, I know this is going to come up later, and I'm going to set it up. So I just threw as far as I could, closed my eyes, and
you got
good things
hammered
happened
on that. And then later you had the game-clinching touchdown. I mean, you had three rushing touchdowns. You knew this was going to be it. Tell me about walking off the field, knowing this was Coach Kleiman's last game, everybody going out to have that kind of performance that day.
It was a ton of fun. It was it really was, though, an emotional month for a lot of reasons with Coach. We had 25, 26 seniors. Yep. 5 years is a long time, spending every day, every second of every day together. And so those guys mean a ton to me. So it was just an emotional deal knowing that this is it. I don't get to do this anymore. It was so much fun. And knowing you don't ever get to do it again, it was emotional.
I watched the ESPN. We had that. We get the melt on that, and I didn't know you got hammered on that throw.
No.
I just we were watching the ball. Obviously, right. We go back. Oh my God, Easton got clobbered on that. Hurt? Imagine, is that a dumb question? Did you feel that?
Like I said, when you don't see it, it's. I can't say it's always better, but sometimes it's better.
You can't grip.
Yeah,
point. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And so I don't know. You get so much adrenaline going, and at that point in the season, they kind of all hurt. Yeah. You know, it's played 15.
You're playing your 16th game of the season
so
by then.
You're beat.
Okay, next is your last game at the Dome, and I'm all the emotion leading to that because that was the week
that
Kleiman had accepted the job at Kansas State. He did his press conference. We're all wondering, it's South Dakota State that you guys are playing to get to Frisco. Give me your thoughts on that, and then to have the game you had that day.
There's so many games you look back on. It's like, man, that was fun. That was my favorite. But I think this one really was. It's the last one in the Dome, Coach Kleiman, South Dakota State, semifinal, the Friday night deal with the graduation, the whole – I mean, it was literally everything. You couldn't ride it better. That was a blast. That's – when I think back to the Fargo Dome, that's the game that I look back on, and man, this place is unbelievable.
There was a shot, I don't know if we have it on here, ESPN had, when you scored that last touchdown, you came over, and it was a long embrace with Coach Kleiman. What do you remember about that?
Yeah, just like we said, it was an emotional week, and he means the world to me, and still does. And I give him more credit than anybody, because I said this the other day, talking with some of the guys, just how cool this program is. I really believe if I didn't come here to play college football, I don't think I'm still playing. I believe in this place that much. And they just teach you the skills. And Coach Kleiman, as many things as you have to do as a head coach and as a defensive head coach where you're still involved in that stuff, he came down on Tuesday and Wednesday every afternoon, my last 3 years really playing, and would sit there and we'd talk about what they're doing, what I'm seeing, all types of football stuff. But then he'd check in on my family. How's your grandma doing? How's your brother doing? And it was real. And that's the stuff that people don't see.
Yeah.
But you can tell the way he carries himself. And you can tell how good his Kansas State teams are and how, you know, they play, how hard they play. And you listen to their press conferences and stuff.
Right?
And the way they talk about
it. Same thing.
It's the way we talk about him. So that's how you know.
We had him on the show last week at his office. He's got a framed number 2 Charger jersey right behind him.
There we go.
It's pretty cool.
There we go. We got to get you one.
We got room.
Yeah.
Number 3 for me is the national championship game in 2018, the James Madison game. Dynamite football game. One of the best I can remember in my time covering North Dakota State. Play that everyone still talks about. It's going to be on the countdown tomorrow. I'm going to tell you, the 50-yard bomb to Darius there. Darius didn't have a touchdown. I called this, by the way. I called it on Friday.
Isn't that
Darius
crazy?
Darius is going to score a touchdown in the national championship game. How did this play come out?
Isn't that crazy? That's hard to
believe,
right?
He didn't have a touchdown prior to that game.
So it was – they played some, like, funky coverages. And when I said funky, just we didn't see him in the valley. Like,
right.
People weren't doing that stuff. And they were really good. And so when you go back and looked at the tape from the year before, we lost in the semis, and it was similar stuff. And you're like, okay, like, here's, like, the space on the field that we need to attack. It's like, how do we do it? Like, how do we manipulate them enough? And so Coach Mess and I, Coach Hedberg, everybody kind of got together and was like, I think this is it. And we repped it and repped it and repped it. We hadn't done it before. And sure enough, I mean, it was, like, as open as it was at practice.
Yeah.
You know, it never happens that way. But it was like, oh, my gosh. Like, just throw
so
it
when
out
you
there.
Saw Darius, were your eyes like, oh, my God, this is going to work.
Yeah. Well, you're really looking at 44 there. It was like that backside safety. I was like, okay, as long as he stays back there a little bit, we should be good. And then all we're looking at is that field corner, and you can see RJ up top.
Yeah.
As soon as that corner turned his back and looked at RJ, I was like, oh, we got this. Easy.
Place went nuts there.
Yeah, it did. It was
and
fun.
That was now, for people that may not remember, that was the year of the mustache. Have you brought that back? Has that come back?
I think that
will it ever come back?
That was a one and done, Dom. And I was peer pressured pretty hard.
I know you were.
Into that situation.
Does your agency know about that? We've got Rep 1. Do they know about the mustache?
If they don't, can we edit,
I don't want them to drop you.
Can we edit this? Yeah. that was tough.
I remember visiting with you on the stage after that because of the game the year prior. You mentioned it. How was there a lot of meaningful wins? Where did that one rank? Because you were the starting quarterback and you led the Bison to the championship that year.
Yeah, it meant a ton because it was the first one I really got to do. 15 was kind of a weird year. It wasn't my team by any means. 16, you lost.
Yep.
And look at, like, Landon Leckler. You look at Chase Morlock and you're like, man, like, that hurt. That was hard. And so to win as the starter, like you said, meant a ton. And then to do it against a team that was one really good. Like, that was probably the best
they
football
team
we ever
played. They had won 24 games in a row coming into that.
They were incredible. Had so many guys. And so that meant a ton. And then just to kind of, to get my own. And I say my own, like, as the starter.
Yep.
Because everyone wants – you get there as a freshman and you're on the sidelines, and it's freaking awesome. Like, this is so cool. And it makes you, you know, look at those older guys. It's like, man, I want to do that. Like, I want to contribute. And so to be able to contribute was cool.
All right, last one, because I know you got to go. This one, to me, is one of my all-time – just the environment was against Iowa. The fourth quarter run you had on the game-winning drive. Was that total – improvisation, or was that, hey, specific call when you ran, I think it was like 20, 25 yards or something, that got you jump-started after Grimsley had the big sack?
Yeah.
Like, oh my, well, actually, before that was the play you threw the wheel route to Chase for the touchdown.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wow, they're going to go for two.
Yeah.
Can you take us in, and then from there, go into
so
that.
Yeah, so he threw the patented.
Here it is, the wheel route.
To Chase.
And he was always open.
Every time. He was the best one at it, for sure. And so, get that. We go for two. We don't get it. There was a blatant hold, pass interference on RJ that they didn't call. But then we were on the 4-week pressure. Robbie gets the sack. And then this was the scheme.
What a great run, man.
The scheme was perfect, though. Coach Riley.
Look at
the
wheels, by the way, huh? Come on, man.
Still got a little bit. Yeah, sneaky. It was a good design, though. Coach Riley and Coach Pete, they played, they don't play a ton of coverages, but you look at them now, they're just really good at what they do, and that's why. They have one of the top defenses every year in the country.
Where were you for Cam's field goal?
Back behind it, on a knee, praying.
Did you watch it or no? Did you not watch?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
I wanted to see it. I was not going to rely on a boo or a cheer and somebody's wrong. I was like, I'm seeing this thing, because you knew he was going to make it. But it's just like, get it over with. Like, kick this thing and let's go.
This is me. I'm running out in the field to try to get it. So literally the camera's on my shoulder, and then I think Jackson Brown's right there. I mean, tell me what you remember about this scene.
Just wild. Really, really wild. And what was crazy is you heard the let's go Bison chant.
Yes.
And you're like, where the heck are we? Like, this is the coolest thing in the world. And that's a neat place to play. Oh. They're right on top of you. You're sitting on the bench. They're chirping at you the whole game.
Yeah.
Getting after you. And so that was a lot of fun.
It's great to see you, man. I really appreciate coming by and giving us a half hour of your time. The camp was awesome. To be up there yesterday to see the guys look at you was really cool. Good luck this year.
Yeah, thank
you. We'll talk again soon, all right?
Yeah, absolutely. Appreciate it.
Easton Stick, NDSU future Hall of Famer, FCS all-time winningest quarterback, joining us here in studio. We will take a break. We'll come back. We'll wrap the show right after this on Hot Mike, WDAY Extra, and Inforum.com. How cool is that? Great to see Easton Stick in studio. Like I mentioned this online last night. I've known him since his junior high school. So to see it now, crazy going into his fifth year of playing the National Football League. And we appreciate him coming by. And that was great stuff. Good to go down memory lane, too. And hearing his – he remembers every single play we talked about there with – did you hear – I mean, literal. There was no – I don't know if I – no, he remembered every single – every second of those plays we showed. That is awesome. Some of them are from 7-8 years ago now. To have that kind of callback, that's what makes elite quarterbacks. And we appreciate him coming on here this morning. That was a lot of fun. A couple things here before we wrap up and get you ready for what to watch. As we mentioned off the top, final day of the All-Star break. There are a couple reports out that the Twins are going to sit with what they got. And you can lament that. I certainly will. that they're going to roll with the guys they have, which makes no sense to me. We're a couple weeks out from the trade deadline. They're a game under 500, as we talked about yesterday when Dick Bramer was on the show. I don't know. Kyle's yelling at me that I think I was expecting something else. Yeah, I should. That's probably stupid on my part. But they got two guys languishing in the minors. Maybe they trade them. I don't know if they think they're going to roll with Joey Gallo and Max Kepler for the last 71 games of 2023. It just kind of boggles the mind on that. So the Twins, literally, this seven-game road trip, three with the A's, four with the Mariners, is going to determine a lot about what happens because they're trending in the wrong direction. Oakland, their record is what they are, but the A's have been playing better. And you go in there and strike out a bunch, and you're going to lose. And then the Mariners are in the same spot where the Twins are, and Seattle had high expectations. They were a playoff team last year. They were better than Minnesota. So it may stand to reason they may get hot soon. Then where you're at. Not good. So we'll see. Second half, as we mentioned, begins tomorrow night all across baseball. One quick deal. Because my Mets will start tomorrow night with the Dodgers. And this is it. They're starting the second half. They're six games under 500 after they won six in a row. Then they lost two of three to the Padres before the break. This is what they have. They got the Dodgers, then the White Sox, and then fittingly enough, when I'm back in New York, they play the Red Sox and the Yankees. That's going to go over well when I see my dad. The Yankees and Mets are playing when I'm back home. That's the stretch, because by the time we get to July 31, August 1, they're going to figure out if they're going to sell everybody off or they're going to roll with this $450 million team and see if they can scrounge a wild card spot because they're 20 games out of first in the National League East. When do the Jets start? Next week is when training camp starts. Let's do what to watch before we get out of here. All right, well, as we mentioned, Wimbledon continues. We've got the women's semifinals happening now, as you can flip it on after we're done here on Hot Mic. The men's semifinals are tomorrow, so something to check out there. The first semifinal is already in the books. The second one is in the second set here. Sabalenka and Jabeur are playing right now. That's on ESPN. The Scottish Open is also underway as golf gets ready for the British Open, which begins a week from today. Tom Hoagie is actually overseas because as part of his exemption, he gets to play in these events. He's on the golf course now, even par through 10 holes. A lot of the top flight players are playing the Scottish Open to prepare for the British Open, which is at Royal Liverpool next week. Rory McIlroy already out with a 64. He's a tie for third. Byung-Hung Ahn is the leader. He shot 61 today. He's at minus nine. Not bad to start a tournament like that. And Tom missed the cut at the Open last year with a 3M Open coming up in a couple weeks. Interested to see how he plays here over the next couple weeks. So that's going on now as well. And then we can't forget our CFL fix.
After we had two ridiculous plays in CFL football that we featured on the show last week, Hamilton and Edmonton, the Tiger Cats and the Elks, 8 o'clock tonight on the CBS Sports Network. That's coming up. I think we're in like week six of the CFL season. That's tonight on CBSSN. One quick story here before we go about the NCAA basketball tournament expansion. The NCAA acknowledged Thursday it discussed possible expansion of the NCAA tournament at the Division I Men's Basketball Committee meeting this week, but also said expanding the field is not imminent. I know we've talked about going from 68 to 96. Apparently nothing on the docket yet. Thanks to our guests today, both in studio, to Steve Laqua and Easton Stick. If you missed any of that, you can podcast it later today at inforum.com. Have a great day, everybody. We'll see you back here tomorrow on Hot Mic on WDAY Extra, KSFL-TV, and inforum.com.
Community play is about more than just providing gyms. It's about building bridges between law enforcement and at-risk kids. It's a place where kids get to know the person behind the badge. And police aren't making arrests and asking questions. Instead, they're giving their perspectives on leadership.